He was on his way to becoming one of hip-hop's major superstars, signed to one of its biggest labels. But with a successful career still ahead of him, Jamal Shine Barrow now calls this place home, the Clinton Correctional Facility in upstate New York. Shine's promise was derailed after an infamous New York City club shooting in 1999. Infamous because of Shine's company that night. He was rolling with label boss and one-time mentor P. Diddy. On March 16, 2001, a jury convicted Shine of the shooting, sending him away for a 10-year sentence and forever changing his life.
So Shine, I think it's, other than a couple of radio phoners here and there, I mean, this is the first time people have heard from you in quite a long time. I guess the most important thing I think people first want to know is how are you doing?
I mean, you hear me? This is not to me what it is to everybody else. This is a journey. I've already been 4 years, so I already got a system, and I already understand that the ultimate goal is to return to the town, and I just spend every day trying to accomplish that.
Can I ask you about being incarcerated? How would you describe the reality for those who might think they know what it's like?
Oh no, this thing is for real. Like, you know, this thing is serious. You know, this is life or death. You dying here. Mm-hmm. You could die in here. You know, they probably won't find your body for a couple of days. Mm-hmm. You understand? So, you know, this is not anything to, you know, take for granted and think that you're going to come here and you're going to get a record deal or you're going to get a joint venture. That's not what I was thinking about. This is just like the town, even worse.
The seriousness of Shine's surroundings hasn't stopped him from working on music. On August 10th, from behind bars, Shine will release his second album, Godfather Buried Alive. It's a record influenced as much by Shine's previous life on the streets as it is his current reality in prison.
Being here is like being dead, because you got people that ain't going home ever. So their life is over. That's why I say buried alive. And when you got a dude that got life, he don't care. He'll rip your heart out.
So how did Shine, a young MC on the verge of success, end up in a place like this? His life, it seems, turned on a single moment in time. It was known as the Puffy Trial. It was his bad boy protege, Shine. The flashpoint for the trial, December 27th, 1999. Club New York in the heart of Times Square, where Puffy, his girlfriend at the time, J-Lo, and Shine arrive for a night on the town. Witnesses say a club-goer instigates a confrontation with Puffy, a confrontation that ultimately leads to violence. The allegations? That Puffy had a gun and that Shine fired a gun, with both fleeing the scene after three people were injured.
I was shot in my face.
Though they were both on trial, Shine was often overshadowed by his headline-grabbing co-defendant. Puffy, whose high-profile relationship with Jennifer Lopez would end during the trial, proclaimed innocence to charges of gun possession and bribery.
I'm totally innocent. I did not have a gun.
The accusations against Shine, though, were more dire. Gun possession, reckless endangerment, assault, attempted murder. Shine's attorneys admitted their client fired his weapon, but claimed self-defense from a mysterious gunman. The trial would put a strain on the once tight bond between Puffy and Shine. And it became even more pronounced when, after 6 weeks in front of a jury, a verdict finally came down.
The verdict is in.
Puffy, not guilty on all counts. Shine, guilty on everything but attempted murder and sentenced to 10 years in prison.
I take it you probably don't give a lot of thought or think much any more about that night at Club New York, 1999.
I had dreams sometimes I'm being killed, you know, and I can't reach for my gun, that I'm being shot, and I can't reach for my gun, you know, because I'm still suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome. Overall, like I said, I put that into a box of destiny. All of that stuff was meant to happen.
Natanya Rubin, the shooting victim most seriously injured that night, might feel differently. But when contacted by MTV News, she declined comment.
No, I don't want to be a bad guy. I don't want to be a tough guy. Not at all, you know. But I had to do the things that I had to do. You know, in that club that night, I had to pull my gun out. I didn't pull it out and wave it around and say, you know, somebody want a piece of me. Somebody was trying to pop my head off. You know, so I had to do that.
Shine's proclamation of self-defense was central to his case. Yet Shine never took the stand and never named who he was defending himself from. It's a crucial detail that could have altered his fate, but it would also have violated Shine's own adherence to the code of the streets.
What I think is important for some people to understand is why, if you could have helped yourself out by identifying someone else or providing other information when you were on the stand, why you wouldn't do that?
Because I was built like that. You know, there's certain rules that, you know, that you abide by. And this is the way I was brought up, that you don't sacrifice anybody in order to spare yourself.
Far from this prison, Shine made his name on the streets of Brooklyn. And although much of the world first got to know him through that trial, sitting in court as Puffy's co-defendant, there's a story behind the life of Jamal Barrow, one that MTV News first told 3 years ago, shining a light on the then 22-year-old MC.
There's no denying that Jamal Shine Barrow has had a tough life. Born in Belize, he's the illegitimate son of a powerful politician, a dad who was mostly absent. His mother, a local woman, eventually moved with Shine from Belize to the rough East Flatbush section of Brooklyn, where the boy learned a whole new life on the street very quickly.
For me, it was like I grew up where, you know, lies ain't mean nothing. Like, I really woke up, you know, going outside knowing, yo, you know, I might die today.
A testament to the harsh reality the young Shine discovered in this country is the 6-inch scar across his chest.
I mean, you know, I got shot. I wasn't no club, you know, it was just in the streets, in the hood, around the way, you know, drama pop off.
Shine feels it was a God-given talent for rhyme that steered him away from further trouble and eventually landed him a straight-off-the-streets audience with some top industry record executives.
He rapped for me over the phone, and I thought he had a lot of talent and a lot of potential.
Shine's obvious promise sparked a major hip-hop bidding war and is rumored to have earned the then-17-year-old rapper a 6-figure signing bonus when he finally decided to go with Puffy Combs' Bad Boy label.
This a bad boy thing.
But Shine was controversial right from the beginning, with detractors complaining that his voice was way too reminiscent of late Biggie Smalls.
Another charge.
The rapper clearly had a violent streak too, having done time as a kid for robbery. In July of 1999, as an adult, he was charged with assaulting a man on a basketball court. Although Shine's lawyers admitted he fired a gun in Club New York, they claimed self-defense. And the rapper and his mother hoped the jury would buy his story.
Jamal wasn't in Club New York to kill anyone or hurt anyone. He was there defending himself.
Like, I always pray and I never ask that I don't suffer. I just ask that I'm allowed to endure my sufferings. You know, so whether sufferance is, you know, being accused of something I didn't do, you know, whether sufferance is, you know, having to prove, you know, my credibility in my music, whether sufferance is, you know, having to watch my mother struggle and suffer, you know, I just thank God for always allowing me to endure it. And I can't, you know, distrust him now.
I remember a couple years ago in an interview, you told us that if you asked anything of God, it wasn't to spare you from, you know, difficulties, but it was to help you endure those difficulties. Do you still feel that way? I mean, this has got to be one of the biggest challenges you've ever faced.
Absolutely. And he did exactly what I asked him. Mm-hmm. You know, when I came through these gates, like I said, there was the why. Was I doing something wrong? Mm-hmm. Was I not supposed to be a rapper? So I was supposed to do something else? Like, what's happening? Let me know something. And when songs after songs, and not just songs, I'm talking about, I got albums, man. You know, Sequence, song 1 through 12, just like Godfather Buried Alive. When all that started happening organically,
right,
I understood, you dig, that I have been given all the power I need, and this is what I'm here for. Because dudes live their whole life for this. Dudes can't, they make one album, can't even get started on the other one.
Right.
I got 10 in my head.
While he was a street star in the making before he went into prison, inside, Shine, sometimes referred to as Shine Poe, has tried to downplay his celebrity.
I don't function like that. Like, I'm 018-3886 to them, you dig? So when I walk around, I don't walk around like, yeah, you know, I'm Shine Poe. You know, I walk around like, you know, I got to handle what I got to handle, and that's that.
Seeing Shine in prison, it was striking how much his demeanor had changed. He was more soft-spoken and wore glasses, barely resembling the brash, hardened MC we had once seen him as. Sometimes evoking his religious beliefs, Shine was born Jewish, it appeared he had matured inside the prison's gates.
Can you give people some idea what a day is like, you know, in your life right now?
For me, like I said, it's not that for me. Like, I don't do anything here that I wouldn't do out in the town, really, you know, because even on the town, like I said, I was a guy that fasted and was making my music. So that's what I do. I make music, I get on the phone when I'm allowed to and handle my BI, you know, go to the yard. You know, I used to run in Central Park. I run in the yard here. I guess the greatest change in my life is letting go. Because, you know, I'm Hebrew, so, like, I don't use the phone on Fridays to Saturday nights. You dig? And, I kind of used to do that on the town because I used to fast on the town for, like, 48 hours. Like, people don't know that. I used to fast 48 hours a week. You understand? But just letting go. Just not watching TV, not listening to what's happening out there. That's the greatest change.
The change goes even further. Shine says that the person we see today is the real Jamal Barrow. And that scarred, gun-toting, thugged-out bad boy, a character he created for the rap game.
I don't want to be a bad guy. I don't want to be a tough guy. I don't like that part of me. I want to change that part of me. I want to get to the point in life where, you know, I couldn't hurt a fly. Uh-huh. You know, even these mobsters that a lot of us rap about, you know, homicide isn't good for business. You know, there's certain things that aren't good for business. All this beefing and all this tough guy, all this antics, it's not good for business.
Or is it? Shine's album, Godfather Buried Alive, speaks to the contrary. It doesn't reflect the mature, wiser Shine we saw at the Clinton Correctional Facility. Instead, his album is filled with the bold, tough guy braggadocio of his pre-prison days, with Shine taking aim at a new nemesis. During the anguish of his 2001 trial for attempted murder, Shine found solace in the one place he felt most comfortable, the studio. While making court appearances by day, Shine spent his nights recording a catalog of new songs.
You know, everything moving past the Shine album is soul music because I finally grew and found my soul. So like when I started making these records and I started going to the studio, when you go in the studio and you're sitting in the court all day and you know, you're facing 25 years, like lights out. You dig? Whatever you do just has a honesty that, you know, is hard to find within yourself. You dig? So when I'm going in the studio, I don't care what this one, I'm not thinking about nothing. I'm crying on the mic, like, this is what I'm feeling. So everything you hear is like my soul, like I'm just pouring my soul out over these beats.
While behind bars, Shine negotiated the buyback of those trial-era recordings from Bad Boy, the label he was once signed to, and the one owned by his co-defendant, Sean Puffy Combs. With that music back in his own hands, industry types were soon buzzing.
Labels have been courting me, I guess, you know, pretty much from like the first year of my incarceration. You dig, you know, started with the more, you know, subsidiary labels like, you know, the Suge Knights and, you know, the Irvs and, you dig, and I didn't want to put out a record at the time. I really wasn't interested. I wasn't gonna wait till I touched the town. But it just kept building up. Like, you know, this year these people will rap about me. Then that year, the next year these people will rap about me. Then, you know, then Jay will call and say, yo, you know, what's up? Throwing my hat in the ring. You know, then Nelly would call. Like it just became an animal, you know, and larger and larger. Magazines just kept writing about it. Well, China's gonna be, you know, is 2004 gonna be his year? Then there were the rumors that I was getting a bail and I was gonna be out. Like, it just spun out of control, you dig? And then I just came to the conclusion that I was being selfish. You know, there's this vast demand for Shine.
Right.
You dig? And you know, I have these records that I love and nobody ever got to hear. Why not let them hear it?
May the angels walk with me.
More or less.
Big things, big rims.
More or less.
big stars and big cars. I could say I've seen it all and done it all.
In April of this year, Shine signed a highly publicized deal for his new album, Godfather Buried Alive. The project is part of a joint venture between his own Gangland label and Def Jam, reportedly worth $3 million.
I wasn't signing as an artist, so anybody that want to talk to me as an artist, you know, just don't talk to me at all. I'm not working for anyone anymore. I'm the boss.
The biggest mystery surrounding Shine's new CD is exactly how one records an album while serving 10 years in a maximum security prison.
Let me ask you about Godfather Buried Alive. One of the main questions I think people have about the record is the time frame that this music was written in. Is the majority of the music on the album stuff that you'd already recorded, or is it stuff that's been done more recently?
I can't really get into that. You dig? It doesn't matter. I can't get into it, but it doesn't matter.
Why is it? Can you tell me why you're not supposed to really talk about?
It's not something. Because you know, like some of the stuff, you know, has been there, but I really don't like more or less. Kanye right. West did that. So once again, you know, it just shows how ahead of everything the music I was making then or now is. Like it's still all relevant. That's the hottest producer in the game, right. And he happened to produce that record.
Obviously, a question that a lot of people are wondering is how you record your tracks, how you record vocals when you're in prison.
Yeah, you don't record vocals when you're in prison.
Did you not do some stuff over the phone or in a?
Nah.
Okay.
I guess this ain't this music. This jail only made me much more ruthless.
Shine's evasiveness may leave the age and origin of his new music in doubt. But there's little uncertainty surrounding the centerpiece track, For the Record, a song in which Shine sizes up one of the biggest rappers in the game.
For the Record, at least in part, really seems to go after 50 Cent. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a bit about if you have any particular beef with 50 and where that comes from?
I mean, you hear me? He's a kid to me, you know? He's like, you know, he's like a little dude, you know? And here we call him our little homies, like, you know? I was just falling back and, you know, I got word that, you know, he might have said something he wasn't supposed to say.
This is about what he said about you possibly talking to Irv about signing with
him? Yeah.
It was late last year when 50 Cent unleashed a lyrical tirade against Shine on New York's Hot 97. After learning that rival Irv Gotti was trying to sign Shine to Murder, Inc.
I heard Irv trying to shine, so I ain't got no love for him. Tell him 50 said he's soft, he won't shoot up the club again.
It's one thing if he would have said it and stood by. That's what I said. You have a problem. Whatever. But he said it, and at the same time, he was trying to sign me. G-Unit Records.
Yo, Paul, what's up, family? This is Sean Money from G-Unit Records. Seeing what's up with your situation, and if you know, interested in signing the G-Unit Records.
So why would you try to sign me, but then you go on the radio and talk like you don't know? Even if you wasn't trying to sign me, bro, you know what I do. Like, I'm not no Liz Aim. I really do this. This is my life.
Right.
I'm not rapping about something that I seen. This is what I do. And I'm sure you heard about what I've been doing since I've been behind the wall. You understand? So I'm really that. I'm not here because my security guard had a gun in the car, you know, and I was trying to get on the front page of Daily News. I'm here for real things.
Right.
You know, it just made me look at him like, oh, man. He's a joke. You can't be serious.
You don't want to ride. You want to get rich and hot.
Is this gonna turn into back and forth beef with him now?
Like I said, that's a little dude to me. Like this can't be no beef with me. You understand? It can't go nowhere. Like he could say whatever he wanna say. This is America, you dig? But I'm not interested in him, and I'm not interested in the response. And you know it's over for me. Like you know, I said what I had to say. I can't say no more than that, right?
Shine doesn't need a beef with 50 to enhance his already established street cred. But will his current prison stint, the verbal spars, and his gangsta persona translate into success?
To those people who would say, you know, oh, he's even got more credibility now that he's done 4 or 5, 10 years, whatever, you know, he's been locked up. What do you think about that? Does that add to someone's, to an artist's credibility?
I'm not here to romanticize this experience. You dig? I'm not here for that. I'm here to just make good music. Like, you don't have to be a tough guy to make good music. You don't. Like, you know, that requisite of being, having that street, you know, the call, that's farce, man. Like, good music is good music. And obviously, I'm gonna touch on my experiences moving forward, but you never gonna hear me dwelling, and you never gonna hear me, like, it's not gonna be no jail records. It's gonna be good music, and obviously, unlike some of these guys, when you hear them rap, you're like, wow, did that really happen?
Right.
Well, obviously, with me, you gonna know, yeah, man, I guess that's when he was in Dennemar.
The blurred line between music and message, image and reality, fueled the career of another rapper, an icon who also once called the Clinton Correctional Facility home. Like Tupac, Shine hopes his music speaks louder than his experiences.
If Machiavelli, you know, didn't make good music when he came out, nobody would have cared about him. But he made great music, best music in history. On the highest level, from Pink Floyd to Bob Marley, his music is great. That's why he mattered. Because I know some real gangsters that used to rap, and they didn't make good music. Mm-hmm. So it don't matter. They don't care how many people they shot. We don't care how much time you did. If the music ain't good, people ain't interested.
Looking at the possibility of parole down the road or work release, are you concerned at all of how they may look at these lyrics and say, oh, look at this. This is not remorse.
That's unconstitutional, though. They can't do that, you know, because this is art. If you look at my album, I have a disclaimer that says, you know, this is art inspired by my life. You dig? So, and as I told you, not because I lived it makes it good music. You know, good music is good music. You know, whether it's my reality or somebody else's reality.
So if someone looks at a lyric like, you know, jail has only made me more ruthless and says, you see there? What is that? You know, is that where he's at? Has it made him more ruthless?
Well, I mean, you know, in you know, the text of that record, it wasn't like I was just saying that wantonly. I was saying that in a particular text. What do you think? I'm gonna come here and, you know, I'm gonna be in this atmosphere. This only hardens your heart. You know, this only, you know, would freeze you. You know, make your veins pump ice. Being more ruthless, you know, that's just in me, like it's in anybody. And this increased it because, you know, there's the bitterness. There's all types of emotions that are there.
One of the tracks, I can't remember which one, you mentioned George W. Bush on there. What are your thoughts? And what is it like watching what's going on in the world from the inside, from the war to this election to Bush and the decisions he makes?
Hey, man, they're going to put me on death row if I tell you what I really think, man. Probably gonna come and kidnap me and take me to Guantanamo Bay.
War for knowledge, I choke, spitting them jewels. Hoping a young future soldier hear me daily. GW Bush, fear me.
Do you think that young people are more, I mean, they always talk about how they're not turning up the vote.
I don't know about John Kerry either, so don't get me wrong.
It's not like you.
I'm not a Democrat and I'm not a liberal and, you know, I'm conservative, you know.
Are you?
Yeah, you know, in my views.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things that, you know, I agree with Bush on, you dig? So I'm not here to be, you know, a liberal or be a right wing. I'm just right and wrong.
George W. Bush, 50 Cent, prison life, violence, drugs. Shine takes aim at a number of loaded topics on Godfather Buried Alive. But there's one subject he avoids entirely.
One thing that I would say that people are gonna be surprised that there's not more of on the record is any overt references to the trial, to the verdict, or to Puffy for that matter. Mm-hmm. Is there any reason that that these tracks don't really address those things?
I mean, you know, I'm not sure. Diamonds and Mac-10s, you know, that was kind of talking about the trial.
The day I stuck my head out my mother's room, I was doomed, repeating the Lord's Prayer, sitting in this courtroom.
But nothing about Puff really directly.
I mean, he doesn't really matter to me. Like, you know, what happened, and for what this was, you know, I felt, you know, it captured everything that I wanted to capture at the time.
Shine may sidestep the issue of his former mentor on record, though he does anything but in our interview. For the first time on camera, Shine speaks out on P. Diddy.
People probably have the impression that you're just consumed with the idea that you know, justice wasn't served here and that somebody turned his back on you.
It's not a matter of, you know, turning your back on me. Like, how do you call a witness to testify against your comrade?
Guns, drugs, money, violence. Shine's new album touches on many familiar themes associated with the hip-hop thug life, but one thing is conspicuously absent on Godfather Buried Alive. Any overt or discernible reference to Shine's one-time co-defendant, label boss, and the man who arguably has had the biggest impact on his life, Sean Puffy Combs.
As you know from the media standpoint, your trial was the Puffy trial. Do you feel that worked against you, all the fact that 99% of the focus was on him?
Obviously, he was the uber star, and I was just up and coming. So, you know, yeah, it's going to be a show. But he used that to just, you know, just threw me off. Like, you know, it was terrible, man.
To many, Jamal Shine Barrow is an answer to a trivia question, as the man who once stood trial alongside Sean Puffy Combs. While all eyes were fixated on the hip-hop mogul, few paid much, if any, attention to the plight of his 22-year-old protege. Now, 3 years into Shine's decade-long sentence, for the first time ever, the imprisoned rapper speaks on camera about his co-defendant and the infamous trial that landed him here, behind bars.
People probably have the impression that you're just consumed with the idea that, you know, justice wasn't served here and that somebody turned his back on you.
It's not a matter of, you know, turning your back on me. Like, how do you call a witness to testify against your comrade?
That witness Shine is referring to is Charisse Myers, a bouncer who was working inside Club New York when shots rang out that December night in 1999. In court, Myers claimed that she fell on top of Puffy during the shooting and said that he did not have a gun. But even as her testimony helped exonerate Puffy, it implicated Shine. Myers told jurors that it was Shine who first opened fire inside the club, letting off two shots toward the ceiling. Shine's lawyers conceded that their client fired his gun, but only in self-defense. Shine has maintained from the beginning that Myers' testimony, asserting that he was the first to open fire on that fateful night, is untrue.
If I'm telling you that she's lying, and you saying, hey, you know, well, she helping me, but I'm facing 25 years, and you looking at probation.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are the things that, you understand, are unacceptable. You don't have to hold my hand. You don't have to do nothing, but don't try to hurt me.
What continues to haunt Shine to this day is that Myers wasn't called by the prosecution, but rather by his co-defendant's legal team. In his eyes, a move that doomed his own defense.
This woman was the most damaging witness of any witness. Mm-hmm. She was worse than the prosecution's witness. Right. Which destroyed me, because the prosecution is saying I'm this belligerent, reckless, you know, okay, corralled fella. Right. And then my co-defendant is saying the same thing? That was it.
MTV News recently asked Sean Combs to respond to Shine's allegations, and he emphatically refuted the rapper's interpretation of events.
I did not force anybody or tell anybody to say anything that would damage or hurt Shine's case. I just wouldn't do that. That would not be my intent whatsoever. And, you know, that's all I'm really going to say about the matter, not to get into any negative back and forth. Because y'all know me over the years on MTV News being involved in certain things. Right now, my life is positive. And I'm going to keep it like that.
Just as damning as Charisse Myers' testimony, according to Shine, was the team of lawyers appointed to him by Sean Combs. Shine says Murray Richmond and others were at one time on the payroll of Combs' record label, Bad Boy. Because Puffy's defense implicated Shine in the shootings, Shine says having his own lawyers bankrolled by Bad Boy posed a conflict of interest.
As I understand it anyway, the fact that your lawyers, as it turns out, originally were on Puff's payroll, on the Bad Boy payroll, that's part of this current effort to get the case retried, right?
More or less. Yeah.
Can you talk a bit about that and when you learned that they were on the Bad Boy payroll?
Well, it was always on the payroll, you dig, but that was at a point where I thought that was my comrade. So, you know, I ain't have it like that. Yeah, right. You know, I was a fledgling artist. Like, right. You know, I didn't, Shine album didn't come out yet, so I didn't really have it like that. But at the point where, you know, he calling witnesses, you know, to do me dirty, then you understand that, you know, well, man, if these guys is working for him, oh, because I went to the judge like 3 times complaining about inefficiency with my lawyers, because they was just dumbing out. Like, right. Witnesses be on the stand, they would ask them 2 questions that didn't make sense and then sit down. It's obvious that they were selling me, you understand, in order to appease him. You know, there was a dual loyalty there.
Shine's trial attorney, Murray Richmond, responded to Shine's accusations by telling MTV News in a statement, quote, "I had absolutely no connection to Puffy Combs. My checks were handed to me by Shine. I'm sorry he feels animosity towards me. I wish him nothing but the best." Sean Combs echoed those sentiments, telling MTV News that despite Shine's charges, he remains supportive.
"I'm not forgetting about Shine. My prayers go out to him. Any support that is needed, you know, we here at Bad Boy, we still here for him. And, you know, we know he's on Def Jam, and we wish him the best of luck. It was an unfortunate incident, nothing that the man meant to do. He was acting in self-defense. He didn't deserve 10 years, and that's my statement."
As you know, XXL reprinted an interview with you from a couple years back. There's a piece with your mom in there. And there's also a response from Puffy in there to some of the allegations that are made that your mom makes. Can I ask you to respond to some of those? Puff in this says that from day one, he offered you his legal team as well. That he said that Johnny Cocker and his guys could represent you as well.
Categorically untrue.
He says he offered to pay for your appeal.
Absolutely not.
He said there's no beef between me and Shine. Absolutely not. Everything's cool between us. Would you agree with that?
I mean, there is no me and Shine. Like, it's, you know,
there's no relationship there to have a beef, right?
Exactly. You know, he doesn't exist to me, and, you know, it's really that simple.
It should be noted that during the course of our interview, which lasted more than 2 hours, Shine never once uttered the name of his co-defendant, Sean Puffy Combs, the man to whom he is inextricably linked.
You know, while your life's been on hold the last 4 years plus, this man has more or less revived Bad Boy. Sean John has blown up. He's run a marathon. He was just on Broadway making his acting debut on stage. He's now got a foot in the political world. He's got this citizen change thing to get young people out there voting. His career just continues on. How does it make you feel to see that happening while everything has to be on hold for you?
I mean, I don't know if that's an accurate assessment because, you know,
you've got the record.
Got the record coming out. We got a joint venture.
So you don't begrudge him any success he's had?
Like, you know, every major artist tried to sign me, you dig, you know, and they rap about me, you know, and, you know, so I've become, you know, I guess, you know, with all modesty, like, kind of a living legend. So while he does what he does, I do what I do.
No desire to speak to Puff, no, what would you say to him at this point? Anything you would say to him?
Nah, there's nothing to talk about. I can't be bothered about what he's doing because, you know, he done did it. His life is, you know, he got it. You know, I need to get mine.
Part of Shine's plan to get his is rectifying what he sees as a wrongful conviction. Shine has hired a team of high-profile attorneys, including Harvard professors Alan Dershowitz and Charles Ogletree, to handle an upcoming appeal. Shine releases his second album, Godfather Buried Alive, on August 10th. More than 3 years after his conviction on assault and other charges. The rapper has also hired a high-profile legal team to appeal his case, lawyers like Alan and Nathan Dershowitz and Charles Ogletree, who once represented Tupac. Shine's appeal is based on the idea that he did not have a truly independent defense from that of his co-defendant, Sean Puffy Combs.
We're looking at issues of conduct by lawyers in the case, by witnesses in the case, and by the judge. Each of those creates possible grounds of error. And that's what we're asking the appellate court to review very carefully to make sure Shine is not above the law. We're not asking for that, but he's not below the law.
Shine's new attorneys filed a brief with the New York Appellate Court in July, asking for either a reduced sentence or an entirely new trial. They expect a decision by the end of the year.
Are the lawyers telling you to be optimistic about an appeal or just telling you wait and see?
I don't talk to them about optimism and pessimism. You know, I have issues and, you know, but it's going to be what it's going to be, you know, because Martha Stewart is a billionaire. She couldn't get off,
right.
You know, so it's going to be what it's going to be. I really, sincerely, that's how I look at it. And I'll accept whatever is, you know, meted out, but I'll continue to dream and I'll continue to hope and hopefully it'll materialize.
I mean, it's got to make you optimistic that things are going to somehow, some way take a turn for the better.
I think they already have, though, John. Yeah. I think you're a pessimist, man. Well, I think they already have, though, you know, when you look at it. I mean, like, I couldn't ask for more. Like, even when I came in, they were playing my songs on the radio. And like I said, you know, they were talking about me in magazines. Like, I don't feel entitlement. I think that the good in my life just towers over whatever negatives. Because all the negatives have led to greatness, whether it be my pops, you know, that just made me have a drive and ambition, you know, that was just, you know, it was unparalleled. And this situation, you understand, has given me all that. Like, I could not rap no more. I don't even have to put this album out. I could not do anything anymore and just leave it alone. And I feel, you know, like my impact, and that's after one album, has been made. And for the people overall to just have a love and an affinity for me, it's like I did it, you know? So there's nothing greater than that, because you can't calculate that. You can't buy that. You can't, you know, guys go lifetimes and never accomplish that. And this is just the beginning, 25 years old. So like my future is ahead of me. And what I have right now here, if I could have this now here, the imagination of what's gonna be when I touch the town, it's like, man, it's gonna be historical. It's historical right now. I'm making history right now. So it's like, you know, in order to get, you gotta give. And I guess I just paid my debts in order to have all I have now, because I, you know, pretty fortunate right now, man.
Where do you think Jamal Barrow will be 5 years from now?
I mean, you know, I hope that, you know, I'll be out there, you know, making great music. And, you know, just doing, you know, the things that I always criticize other people in powerful positions for not doing. You know, I'm hopeful, I dream, but it might not be that way. I might need to go through more. I might need to experience more in order to be perfected to accomplish what it is I'm supposed to accomplish in this universe. You know? But I hope that, you know, wherever I be, I won't be there. I won't be in the material. So when I'm in the trunk, when I'm in Beverly Hills Bungalow, I really won't be there. I'll be in my soul. You know? So, yeah, that's the answer. I hope I'll still be in my soul and not in the flesh and not in the world.
Well, hopefully the next time we talk, it'll be
on
elsewhere.
On the town, yeah.
So, hey, absolutely. Best of luck with the record, man.
All right.
I know a lot of people looking forward
All right.
to it.
All right.
Good luck.
All right.
Thanks.
Sick things, sick rain. Sickening, sick chain, sick aim, fifth bang, fifth flame. Bail money, lawyers acting funny when I come through. Hit them with a bundle, on the humble.